With all that being said, I'm very excited to bring your host to the stage. You know them as the host of Action Live. Guys, start clapping right now for Bateman!
Faces as team action. I mean,
there it is. You guys have any questions for me? Because I got one for you, and that question is,
where's the belt?
In all seriousness, God, those belts are really, really hard to get a hold of. A couple seasons down,
learn the hard way.
I'm gonna set this here if you don't mind.
Guys,
what is going on? This is
team action love for you guys, and you know, you guys are always sitting at home talking about how good you are at trivia, how you know all the answers on the show.
I was on the stage. Ben and Drew suck.
You know what, Brandon Hanley, you're a moron.
Yeah.
So we thought we'd ask you a couple of MacGruber centered trivia questions. Start out tonight, give out some free stuff, you know, see what you guys really know.
Who here's a fan of the movie MacGruber? Do you guys like it? Yeah. It was lukewarm. That was lukewarm.
I've seen it before.
For this.
Okay, alright. So then we'll start off real, real easy for you, okay? This recently deceased actor plays the captain, the colonel, in MacGruber.
I heard a sound from back there. What do you got?
Dollar spoof?
And fucking idiot. He's right. That's a good question.
For your win, you're going to get a Ghai dabble.
What is a Ghai dabble, may you ask?
I'm just
looking. Sports.
Nice.
Sports.
Question number two. We're wearing sunglasses.
Right, sorry, I can't see anything.
Okay, question number two. Who are the two people Mickey has to impersonate in the film MacGruber? Character names. Who are the two people that Vicky Samp Elmo impersonates? Nope. They don't like the movie MacGruber. This is a mistake. Come on, right here. We got it.
I know one of them is MacGruber.
That's a good start.
Oh, you put him on. This is round two, man.
Come on, you're on your own. You're on an island.
I don't have no.
Multiple, multiple choice. You're a moron. You're a moron. Or
Boss Bender.
Which one? A, B, C,
or D.
D.
He's right.
Give him something. You get action coins. You guys are gonna get something. Throw it out.
Vicky St. Elmo was shot in a South American country. It's gonna be exactly like blank. I got shot in blank. It's gonna be nothing like blank. What country did Vicky St. Elmo get shot in?
This is for an Action Live t-shirt.
Ooh.
We'll sign it later, maybe. For $25.
No?
I'll take a guess.
Oh! I heard someone say it, but they didn't raise a hand. Xenia, what you got?
Was it Budapest?
No.
Avengers. It's a good guess. It's a good guess. Someone keeps saying it, so they gotta raise their hand.
Nicaragua.
All right,
yes.
There it is.
Over here?
Yeah.
There it is. Nicaragua. All right, we do have to say, even though she got the question wrong, happy fucking birthday, Janine!
Missile in MacGruber.
I know what the blank is.
Yeah,
what
is that?
Did you guys watch the goddamn
the low missile.
What?
The low missile, I don't know.
Close. Do you know the answer, Andrew? Do you want to win this Action Live postcard?
Is it signed by you?
Yes, it is.
I want it.
Alright, we'll go easier then. Who plays MacGruber's wife, actress, in the movie? That, right there, right in the back, white shirt. Oh, see?
Oh,
I got one! Front row.
Stage right.
That's
wrong.
It. It's a real thing.
No, it is. It's right. Yeah, you got it.
You got it. You got it. Keep this right down the line. What year was MacGruber released?
What is that?
There it is. Dolman's got it. You get, you get a Benguin.
A Benguin.
Stop trying to make Benguin happen. It's not going to happen. Guy and Apple worked, so we had to come up with a second one to match it. It was a bad idea. All right, last one. Last question. That's another shirt. You want to come up with one on the spot, or want to just do something off the hip here? I mean, I got a bunch more in here, but this is a little deep. I don't want to do that to you guys. You got it.
Do it.
All right, fine. How many Purple Hearts has MacGruber been awarded? And remember, you have to get injured to get it to get harder.
Two.
Somebody knows it?
16.
Yeah! Match number one, we got Erwin versus Fouch. Erwin should have been a Team Action member, you know that?
No!
We tried, they should have been. Look, we tried to get Erwin from day one, and he said that he would be on board. Christian immediately squashed that. Didn't even last 30 seconds. Not for a second. I have to go. Actually, you know, let's do this first. Let's get a show of hands here. Who thinks that Haley Fouch is going to take it? Two people. One, two, three. Okay, it's like a fair fight. It's like a fair fight.
All right, we got Forza Alex over here in the front.
I'm with you guys. I think Erwin is one of the scariest people in the entire league. I have no idea where that guy came from. I remember when Ben and I saw him in the first free for all.
Yeah,
it was just astounding. His knowledge is terrifying. Incredible. Christian created him in a lab.
He did
somewhere.
Weird lab.
I think the first match, I mean, for me, it's just easy. Erwin is one of the most incredible minds the league has ever seen. I like Fouch.
I like Fouch a lot.
Hey, but you know how it is when you are expected to beat the underdog.
Yeah.
Never heard that underdog do.
Dammer!
Hey,
Ben, how many two-time champions have you beaten?
Just wanted to ask, how many people have you hit with chairs and wrestling rings? So I think I'm going Erwin.
I gotta go Erwin.
Now let's get to the really interesting match, guys.
This is actually very interesting.
We got Jeff the Insider Snyder. You guys like Snyder? Let's get a round of applause for Snyder. More than Paul. How did that still have prime time Paul Oyama?
Yeah!
It's middling. The rookie's got some love. I mean, I can't stand him. I remember the first time that I met Paul in person, I was there for one of your singles matches before we departed as Team Action, and I was just screaming at your opponent. And he kept looking at me and rolling
as
his eyes.
As I always do.
Still, I bet you missed that. He just kept looking at me and rolling his eyes. I walked over and said, who the fuck is that kid over there? I don't like him. Well, that's Paul. That's the kid that's been killing it in the fan leagues. I go, fan leagues. What a joke. What does he know? Well, he's better than I am. I remember I was on the phone with Christian one day, and I was like, God, this is why before I got the title, I was like, Yama kid, he's such an arrogant, cocky prick. I don't like him. There's no respect for the game. I was like, oh my
he just
God.
Comes into the league, and he's just trying to put on a show, and he has no respect for the veterans.
And I was like, oh my God, I am John Rogan. That's my name.
And that one phone call meant at age 20 years.
Started bawling, I got a gut, got real angry. Alright, I think that's about enough of this Team Action shit. Let's get to the real show. Those characters are the worst parts of Ben and I. Andrew just turns that character on the coffee shop sometimes. He just lets him do it. He just leans into it whenever he wants to.
No!
It's just a character, bro. It's just a character. My bad. Although our fantasy football draft, he came out tenfold. Smets joined our fantasy football draft.
Oh, yeah.
That guy's an idiot. Destroyed. Andrew was relentless. I think Smets started to get rattled. I could see it in his face. He wasn't having fun anymore. He was like,
you guys take this pretty seriously, don't you?
So I think without further ado, we want to get to the regular show here. And I just want to let you guys know that, you know, I'm Ben Bateman.
And I'm Andrew Ghai.
And we are
the Action Guys!
We love you guys so freaking much. This is one of the biggest, best nights in either of our lives.
Great.
You guys are all a part of it. So first of all, thank you for being here. Thank you for all the support over all the years. Thank you to the New York Comedy Club, and especially Amy and Mark Ellis, who set this up for us.
Yes.
Faces here. A lot of people were very happy to see. Action Industries has been alive now for about, 8 months or so, and 25% of this room basically works with us to make the brand work.
You guys will not get paid unless you buy tickets for our live show.
Just kidding, we don't pay. We gave you sweatshirts. I see one there.
Yeah, there they are.
Action Industries represent. So we got one more little surprise for you guys before we jump right into the show, and it's actually going to come from this television behind me. Because, you know, MacGruber's been a favorite of ours for a long time.
Yeah.
You know, we always talked about wanting to do it on the show and really just making it count when we did it on the show, and we felt like we had something we had to show you guys.
I think this is it.
So, yeah. Get out of the way. Let's cue it up here.
Just doing my morning reflections. You like the mustache? Want to sit on it? Yeah, I know you. Get your mind out of the gutter, you perv. Welcome to Action Industries. Will you be taking a look at MacGruber tonight? And I thank you for that. You have a great night, y'all. Ta.
To our friend Will Forte for making that happen for us. You know, we've been talking about getting Will on the show for years to talk about MacGruber, and
he ghosted us.
Yeah, he did. For like 2 years. And then we reached out to him, we were like, hey man, we're going to be at New York Comedy Club, and he just immediately was like, I'm in. Whatever you guys want, you know, let's do it. And so he sent that to us this morning, and let's give a round of applause for him. Yeah. Guys, this is action movie anatomy. We cover action movies on this show, we do. The adhere to four basic rules. Rule number one, the hero always plays by their own rules. MacGruber definitely plays by his own rules.
Yeah, MacGruber don't play like Homie, and Homie don't play like that.
Rule number two, the hero and the villain are always the smartest people, beings, things, dinosaurs, what have you in the room. MacGruber's a moron, so is Comic. I mean, outright, there's no question, they're both dumb. So
it doesn't quite land. They can maybe also be the dumbest people in the room. You know, you're stupid smart.
Yeah, I know something about that.
I know something about that.
I know a lot about that. Rule number three, the hero must be a police, military, political figure, or mercenary.
Or mercenary.
Because, you know, he could work for the man, he could be the man, he could be an MTA operator, the table called 1, 2, 3. It's like that, I don't know.
That movie's terrible.
You're wrong. And rule number four, a minimum of one explosion. There are definitely explosions in MacGruber, so that is why we're going to be covering it on the show today. And guys, the first thing we're going to do is hop into a thesis statement. You know what this is your biggest, boldest thought about the movie. If you were in New York at a comedy club and two jackasses were doing a show about a movie called MacGruber, and you had a chance to say something, this would be the one thing that you said: order another drink, and then keep watching the show.
Yeah, it should never just be like, this is my favorite this. It should be the greatest, the first, the last, the only. This is the point you make at the party before you drop the mic and walk out.
We won't drop the mics.
No.
Respect. I'll jump in first and say, this is the greatest spoof movie ever made.
Yeah.
Woo! It's the greatest spoof movie ever made. And I qualify that really, really particularly because, like, the one that came to mind that was the closest movie was Tropic Thunder. Yeah, but I think this is a better movie. I think MacGruber is more clever, it's more interesting, relies on less. But it's truly a spoof movie. I mean, think about what Will's doing in that video there. He's spoofing American Psycho. That's not an action movie. That's just a movie that he wanted to poke fun at. Right? The hero qualifier stuff, you know, 16 Purple Hearts. That's just straight out of Rambo. You know, Rambo, John Jay. Or, like, that's exactly what that is.
Well, that's what makes a good spoof movie, right? Is you have to sit there and you have to take it just as seriously as all the other movies take themselves, right? It's just as seriously as Rambo takes itself, just as seriously as American Psycho takes itself. However, if you're going to spoof it, you got to have someone like Powers Booth, a legendary actor. Every scene that Powers is in, he brings 100% sincerity.
Steals the scene.
You believe that guy thinks he's in a better movie than he's in. But he's actually in the greatest action comedy of all time. So, before I jump in with mine, does anyone have a thesis statement that they would like to share about? Right there, Kearnsy.
Matt Kearns runs Twitter for Action Industries.
Greatest power booth performance since Sudden Death.
Sudden Death.
Did you think I wasn't going to mention it?
Sudden Death Hunters. Stay tuned for that one. Yeah, stay tuned for that
next
one.
Next year?
Coming anytime soon. Might move it around.
Oh, sometimes. Okay.
I'll be Roka's age by the time you do it.
And I'll be dead. I'm going to piggyback on that because I actually believe that this is the greatest performance by any of the actors in the movie, the main characters in the movie. Kristen Wiig, Will Forte, Ryan Phillippe, Powers Booth, and Val Kilmer. Every single one of them. I know, you might say, you're biased. You're right, I am. But honestly, I love every single one of their performances. I think Vicky St. Elmo maybe is the most understated one of them all because MacGruber just kind of steals the show, but her, can wait. These are my favorite thing. And also, like, four is a perfect, like, that whole song about four being the most perfect number. Just two kids and me and you.
We promised some live music, guys.
Yeah, this is does anyone else have a thesis statement that they'd like to share about the movie? If not, we're going to keep moving on through the show. But, you know, you guys always like to share in the chat, so we thought we'd open up to you guys here.
Give a shot. Give a shot. What do we got right here?
Oh.
Right here.
Best Val Kilmer performance.
Best Val Kilmer performance.
Ever.
Whoa.
We call her
Kiss Kiss Bang Bang.
Well,
yeah.
I think it's really wonderful you mention this because Kilmer was entering this phase of his career where he's starting to become Fat Sweaty Kilmer. Yeah, right? He's not all the way at Fat Sweaty Kilmer yet, but this is the beginnings of it. Kiss Kiss.
Yeah.
And then 2010 MacGruber comes out and you're like, this is the guy I was waiting for.
So you know how much I love Batman Forever. And you know how much I love the Saint.
He's very handsome and skinny in those films.
When I saw him come out in MacGruber, when I finally watched it, I screamed.
I was so excited to see him. Pure joy.
Pure joy. And also, this is the bad guy. You knew immediately that he was going to be the bad guy in the movie. And
yeah, I don't know.
I could not agree with you more, Alex. Thank you so much. Alex helps run our Discord. So,
that's great.
Hey, we got one more. What you got?
Silliest cameo by professional wrestlers in a movie ever.
Ever. Oh, yeah.
Yes. Chris. Okay, so his scene with Chris Jericho was completely improvised, which is something that my friend Jeremy would say every single time we watch it. No matter, we've probably seen it maybe like 30 times together. Every single time, he'd be like, man, this part, totally improvised.
Did you know this part?
Did you know it was totally improvised? Because it was. Danuzi, you got one?
Jim, best use of a vegetable in a movie ever.
I watched it. I saw a hand go up front. Kyle, what you got?
He fucks a ghost.
You fucks a ghost, yes.
That's a
strong point.
That's a bad thesis.
That's a strong thesis.
One of the best movies, I guess, where somebody fucks a ghost.
I don't know. It's like, well, there's this movie, and then there's ghosts.
And there you go. So.
Let's go Plaid first, and then the guy right next to him.
So let's go best movie featuring Saturday Night Live alone.
Ooh, that's a tough one. I'll make a little more than that.
What are you talking about?
You're talking about this is better than Tommy Boy. And I can't get on board with that.
Yeah.
Tommy Boy is a top 12 movie all time. That's like, it's almost about Rushmore.
It's okay, this is your thesis. It's not him. Can I agree? It's tough because I love Tommy Boy also. I do love MacGruber more, I think, than
Tommy Boy.
You got
50-50 shot up here. They're two of my 50 favorite films. Give me that.
I mean, one of them's an action movie and one of them is Tommy Boy.
Straight comedy, that's true.
Yes.
Yeah, they don't want to do their own thing. What you got?
He stole mine, so I'm going to work around it a little bit. Top three part of the top three best movies based off of an SNL sketch. Right up there with Blues Brothers and Wayne's World.
Nice. Yeah, that's a strong one. That's a good one. Yeah.
Given the run,
it's also the only.
That says a lot, given the SNL run.
I think, to piggyback on your point, I think this is the only SNL film that is clearly better than the sketch.
Yeah.
Because you got what? Because the other ones you're missing there, like Porky Romano, you've got Roxbury.
Conehead.
Ladies Man. Ladies Man. Tim Meadows used to always come to the bar in the Venice.
Superstar.
That Ben and I used to work at. Tim Robbins used to come there. Tim Meadows used to come there. That's how we met Will Forte. That's how we met Forte. When you would come into the bar,
yeah.
You'd always remember our names. Made us feel a lot more than waiters at the time. That was cool.
We weren't.
All right, does anyone have any thesis statements? If not, we're just going to keep moving right on through the show. Rachel's got one.
I think it's one of the best male wish fulfillment movies of all time. Any guy walks into the room and like, I can totally do that!
Because we're all just like MacGruber.
I've been at home sharpening a thumbtack for the show tonight.
So the next part of our show that we get into is this thing we call fist pump moment. Something happens, you kind of look around, you're like, have you seen this right now? This is so awesome! I get to watch the rest of this movie right now! You want to call your buddy and literally be like, dude, turn the movie to 17 minutes right now.
I don't care.
Turn it to 17 minutes. Done. You have to watch this. It matters.
Fine.
That's fist pump. It really matters to you, and we are going to share our MacGruber fist bumps. In the green room, we were talking about yours. Just
yeah.
A second.
Oh, yeah, 100%. It is Eddie Money's Take Me Home Tonight. When he gets out of the car at the party, he was not even supposed to go to. Sir, we'll be there with bells on. I don't want you here. I'm not going to wear bells. Still shows up. Comes out, Eddie Money wears the sexiest suit I've ever seen in my life. Sir, can I take your jacket? No. Your car stereo? Nice try. That whole scene, his hair, the upper decker of the master bathroom, everything about it is beautiful, and it's also like...
I'd explain
that. What's that?
I'd explain what upper decker was. It's
a good conversation to have with your mother. There's just something about it. Because, you know, you watch the movie, you're like, God, this is such a good time, this is so fun, but you figure it's going to kind of peter out, it's going to lose its momentum. But when that song kicks in, the pacing of this movie, that's another thing, is they get all the great beats of action movies that you want. The location changes, the parties, the highs, the lows, all that. Well, there's probably a lot more lows than highs in MacGruber. But that, ladies and gentlemen, is my fist pump moment. Yeah, I'll jump in with mine, and I will say, it's the thing I mentioned a second ago, and it's the hero qualifier moment when he's like the legendary MacGruber. And Piper, Ryan Phillippe, the best Ryan Phillippe role model.
That it really is.
Yeah, it literally ruined his career. He's not been in anything since his career. That's right. Didn't he do like Lincoln Lawyer before this? He looked like he was starting to come back.
I think
back.
The next year, he's like kind of a shit weasel on that movie.
Yeah.
And then he's just gone.
2 years later.
2 years.
Okay, 2 years.
Oh, wow.
Oh.
Where were you when we were asking questions? No, you wouldn't have gotten it wrong. Are you positive it's 2012?
Yes.
Do you want to do this?
No, I
just want to do this right now.
We're not going into that.
Yes.
So, but I think it's, you know, it's Piper's like, oh, the legendary MacGruber. He starts listing the things off, right? And he's like, you know, 16 Purple Hearts, the Congressional Medal of Honor, and the starting tight end for the University of Texas, El Paso. You know, and MacGruber's like, that was a long time ago. But we always talk about how, like, the genre, the action movie genre, you know, why do we like Mike Banning so much? Why does it matter to us that Banning is Special Forces Ranger Battalion? He will move mountains or die trying. Trust me, I know this guy. Like, those things matter in movies because they're all derivative, right? It's the same thing every time. And so this movie gets it. Like, literally the line in The Rock where the guy goes, like, and the Congressional Medal of Holy Shit, this man is a hero. And it's like, I think legend is more likely. So I think it just matters to me so much in this movie when I'm watching it, it happens. I'm like, this is somebody, this is clearly the scene from Rambo 3. This is absolutely what we're watching. And they're just giving homage to everything you've ever watched in a movie. That's why that scene to me is just like, these guys get it. I love those scenes in all the action movies. Hero qualifier was the thing we used to talk about on the show all the time.
Yeah, I mean, and there's also a great villain qualifier in this one, right? Like, he steals a nuclear warhead at the beginning of the movie, and you also find out that he kills the main hero's wife. He murdered his wife on their wedding day. Although, if you keep watching the movie, you kind of find out that MacGruber's actually the villain.
He's kind of the bad guy.
He really is. Like, Dieter and Maya were having a great relationship. They were with child. So naturally, I had it terminated. And it's so dark. It's so horribly dark. But you know what? For some reason, you're still completely on MacGruber's side. 100%
on board. I can't really say why.
I know, you're like watching, like, this is horribly funny. This is great.
Could be the mullet, I don't know.
It's the mullet. Definitely. Does anyone have any fist bump moments that they would like to share with the room? Kernsy?
Just Fat Kilmer.
Fat Kilmer, yeah. Okay, do you take 2010 MacGruber Kilmer or 2010's era Fat Sweaty Russell Crowe, which is better?
Oh.
Yeah.
Wow.
Everyone's really invested in that.
That's
tough. That's a strong point you made, man. God, that's a tough one. Because it's essentially, do you take Kilmer and MacGruber, or do you take Crowe in the nice ass?
Or do you take Crowe having to ride bikes prior to the film?
Should we tell that story?
We heard from somebody that we know that worked on that film that Russell Crowe showed up apparently in worse shape than he had when he auditioned. And they already were unhappy with the shape he was in. And he was coaxed by the director to go like riding bikes for the 3 weeks prior to the film to try to run weight, which didn't work at all.
I just imagine Shane Black and Russell Crowe riding bikes in the morning. Russell Crowe being like,
for some reason, my image is like Russell Crowe eating like soft serve while riding a bike. I mean, I don't know. I just like that era of Crowe so much.
I saw cannoli.
It was a tandem bike.
Crowe's on the back.
The back does all the lifting. I think I gotta go. Oh man, why you gotta do this to me in front of all these people?
Pick your boy.
I think I will. I gotta go Crowe. I know, it's crazy because I love Kilmer so much in this, but like, man, for someone that grew up loving Gladiator as much as I did, Gladiator is my favorite movie of all time.
Yeah.
He's like a legend, right? Like, he's like rugged, sexy. Fighting for his wife. He's a general of army, commander of the Northern Legions. And then he comes out in the nice guys.
I think it's the greatest thing
I've ever seen.
You make a strong point because, you know, Crowe took his career from like the 2000s, and then in the 2010s, he just reinvented his chin. he made the conscious decision, like, I'm going to have a new chin for the rest of my career.
If one chin can win an Oscar, then two chins can win an Oscar.
So, I think that's my answer to the question.
Yeah. You going to take Crowe also?
100%. I mean, there is not an actor who has done the Fat Sweaty transformation better than Russell Crowe. He just has done it. He's
did it
fully. He's got it.
Alright, I'm on board with that. What do you guys think? Any more fist bumps out there? If you don't have any more, we're just gonna keep moving. Alright, right here, Dylan, what you got?
So actually I'm gonna say the way that Dieter von goes out.
You gotta say his name.
There's a T.
You gotta say his name.
There's a T.
The way he actually dies is probably one of the best, most over-the-top villain deaths in any action film.
While fuck you, dude!
While falling off of a cliff, he was shot with an M16 and pissed on while exploding. And has no dick in him.
After he's been burned so bad that, yes, he no longer has a penis.
Yeah.
So,
it's a strong death, it's a strong growth.
I think he's coming back in MacGruber 2.
I really
do, man. I really, really do. It's another hand up over here with the fist bump. Yes, what you got, Danny?
Shoot up the van
and
she's in the coffee shop and just goes crazy into it. I love it.
Yeah,
also, the person who watched MacGruber was on the live stream. Just
want to
say
we
that.
We did a live stream. Yes. Patreon-only live stream. Shameless plug, patreon.com/teamaction. And we have a watch MacGruber video. It's fantastic. So
my favorite part about that scene is actually when he's like, all right, we're outside, we're only 7 blocks away. She's like, 7 blocks? All right, you got me. We're 20 blocks away. Were there any spots closer? No, there were tons of spots. Yeah! With meters! Idiot!
How much he shits on Piper is actually, I think, my favorite part of the whole movie. He breaks his nose when my fist bumps too. Alright, we're gonna move on to the next part of the show here, guys. So, we're gonna get into star profile. Yeah, this is gonna be a little bit more of the classic show that you guys know. It's a really interesting time in both their careers. You know, Will Forte was doing Claudia with a Chance of Meatballs in 2009, Fanboys in 2009, and The Slammin' Salmon, which is a movie by the Broken Lizard crew. If you watch, seen it. It's not a great movie, but it's not horrible. He sits in the bar or the restaurant for the entire movie during this shit show of a shift at a restaurant, which I'm sure you and I can relate to. And he's one dude at a table that doesn't order anything, like sits there, he's like a hot water with lemon type of guy for like 4 hours. You know, you hate him. Like, the worst. I made money, get the hell out of here. He's like, can I get another lemon? He ends up leaving a huge tip at the end of the night.
And I don't know, he's kind of like the silver lining in the movie, because the movie kind of sucks for everyone else. But that is what I remember from that. But he wasn't really doing anything, honestly. Like, he was still trying to break through. And we were actually having a conversation earlier today, I'm going to segue, about Bill Hader versus Will Forte. Bill Hader is exponentially more famous than Will Forte.
Right, like, he had, like, and it was on the backs of a few things, I think, right? Like, you watch a movie trailer for Trainwreck, and you see a scene with LeBron James and Bill Hader. Like, I think that alone right there just kind of puts you up on the next level in the general consciousness. Plus, you added Inside Out and all these other animated films.
Well, he also, you gotta remember, that was also the time when Amy Schumer was the hottest thing in the world.
Yeah,
the hottest. You know? And then right now, with It 2, he's in that as well. So he just, and Inside Out, maybe the greatest animated film ever made, maybe the best Pixar film ever made. All these things, so maybe it's just his management team.
I guess,
Barry.
Yeah, he's got Barry on HBO, right? People talk about that show like it's one of the best shows out there.
Watch that.
And, you know, Forte was doing Last Man on Earth for a few years there on Fox. That show's great. If you guys haven't watched it, it's really funny. But it is weird how it's like, you would have thought that at this point, if Forte had gotten any of those animated roles, because that's what I was saying, I think he's one of the funniest guys out there, period.
Yeah.
Like, everything I've ever seen the guy in blows my mind.
Oh, even my girlfriend, actually. Hey, how you doing, baby? She was even saying that, she's like, oh, I know him from SNL. And like, when you recognize people from something, usually you expect them, because like, people being on SNL is, it's a big deal. It was a lot bigger deal back in the 90s and early 2000s. Nowadays, I can't tell you anyone on the cast of SNL. I think maybe, no, I can't. Like,
I'm probably 5 years behind on everybody.
Yeah. So like, even the fact that you recognize, like, oh, I know Will Forte. I've seen him in things. For some reason, he never seemed to break through to that next level. And honestly, he still kind of has it. I consider him still a B actor. Not talent-wise, I mean, my God.
No. But yeah, I think in terms of fame, it's true. Like, it's you almost would have thought the Last Man would have done it more. But
do you think Bill Hader's funnier than him?
No.
No.
I think Hader's really funny. Hader has tremendous impressions. But I mean, Forte on a pound-for-pound basis makes me laugh more than almost anybody I can think of from the SNL crew in the 2000s. It's like,
yeah.
Farrell, a couple other guys. Like, that's all there is for me.
Yeah. All right, well, Bill goes on, right?
And Val Kilmer's career over here, his three previous films were Bloodworth, Double Identity, and Hardwired. He was at a very interesting part of his career. Never heard of any of those films.
Not a damn clue. Has anyone seen or heard of any of these movies?
Celebrate his entire career.
All right, Belford, give me a breakdown synopsis of Double Identity 2009.
Yeah. There's a movie from around this time period where Malcolm plays a dead body in the movie, but he's a significant role. He just doesn't ever speak. He's a dead body for like a lot of the movie. I remember it was like a thing. It could be one of these films. Obviously, Kilmer, I think from what I understand, is in Top Gun 2, so that should be a big comeback for him. Huge fan of the guy. He was in a film called Felon, I think, a couple years before this. And it's directed by Rick Robin Wild, the guy who just did Angel Has Fallen. Brandon Cherry.
I love Angel Has Fallen. And I think, actually, I'm glad you brought up Angel Has Fallen, because Angel Has Fallen, who here cares if we spoil Angel Has Fallen? Okay, that's what we did. That's just what I figured. This is what the thing was with Angel Has Fallen, and the reason I want to talk about it with MacGruber is we were talking about cliches, like action movie cliches, and the way that MacGruber falls it so soundly, that's what makes it such a great spoof movie. But with Angel Has Fallen, it's another one of those examples of an action movie doing nothing new at all. You knew who the bad guy was when you saw him. You knew who was going to betray him. You knew that Tim Blake Nelson was the shit weasel. All these things you knew.
100%.
You even saw the drone strike in the trailers, but for some way, Rick Roman Waugh was able to make it new, flavorful, exciting.
You knew that Jerry was very out of shape and didn't look great, but he was still going to be faster than all the guys he had to fight. Somehow, he was going to disarm people with one hand, he was going to run faster.
He's like, Rick Roman, I need to have a pill problem.
He's like, I'm not going to get in shape for the film, Steven. Tell him I won't get in shape. Tell him I've got pills. I need a drug problem, Steven. So, Jerry, you have a drug problem. I need a drug problem, Steven. You go to the film?
So, yeah, anyway, I just think the Angel Has Fallen is a movie that just follows those by-the-number beats so well, but still somehow ended up coming out on top. Now, MacGruber obviously follows them and then spoofs them, but I think it's something to pay attention to.
Make no mistake, guys, MacGruber was a flop. This movie lost money.
A horrible flop.
I mean, there is a pilot that got announced a couple of years back, I think a year and a half ago, they were going to make a TV show. They announced they were going to come on and do it, and we're still very hopeful that happens. Obviously, you know, any news we get on that, we'll be sure to share with you guys. But I'm very hopeful. I still think it should happen. I think people would watch it. I think this movie has a cult classic following. Yeah, I really do think so. And talking about that, we'll get into critical and box office. This movie only cost $10 million to make, which is a pretty substantial steal, if you ask me. I mean, if I can make this movie for $10 million, I wonder how I got $10 million, but I'd still make it. It opened May 21st, 2010. It only made $8.5 million domestically. What's the most interesting about that is that its opening weekend, it made $4 million. So that means it made half of the money that it made in its opening weekend, which also means that everyone out just talks shit about it. Yeah, right? Yeah. I have memories of people I knew being like, this movie is way funnier, but no one's going to see it. The sketch is terrible. The movie's really funny. Yeah, the sketches were stupid. I remember watching the sketches, like, prepping to go see the movie. I didn't see the theaters because it looked bad. The sketches looked bad. Like, it did. I mean, it just wasn't my type of humor, and I felt for a while that SNL had been missing. But MacGruber came out of it, and it only grossed $8 million total domestically, and only, like, $737,000 worldwide. So all in all, this movie lost about $1.5 million, or around $1 million being made, which is why there is no sequel.
Yeah, they had written the sequel. We talked to Jorma, the you know, Jorma Taccone,
yeah,
director at one point about it. They were hopeful. They had a script written. They wanted to do it.
Do you think anyone's star power is big enough that they're going
to make? I don't know. You put The Rock in the sequel, probably gets made.
$10 million, he can fund it himself.
You recast, if you recast MacGruber as Tom Cruise, maybe the film gets made, you know?
Dieter von Kant is The Rock.
The Rock? Cruise versus The Rock.
Oh, that's fun.
Yeah.
Recast for a real MacGruber?
That's what Russell was in the sequel.
Well, yeah, he's just Dieter von Kahn's dad. This movie's got a 5.5 on IMDb.
IMDb's a crock of shit.
IMDb is a crock of shit. I will agree with you wholeheartedly. It should be in the top 250. It's not. It's got a 48% on the tomato meter and a 35% the audience. That's where I'm wondering what the hell happened. What, guys, we are supposed to be the representatives of the audience. 38% cult classic, why? Tell me, if you can pick apart this movie, tell me why.
Well, considering, what was
Get
the,
out.
What was the horrible film we watched recently? It was like a 95% or something like that. It was like,
oh yeah.
I can't remember, but Danny had something to add here.
It came out in 2010. What part of 2010 did it come out in?
May,
okay, so
yeah.
Early 2010. I know that it's not close to like when everything happened or anything like that, but still, like action movies were spoofs around that time were not popular.
It's just a thing that people didn't want to see. I mean, I didn't see it. I'm part of the reason why this movie didn't do well.
I didn't watch it.
You saw it opening night?
Who here actually saw MacGruber in theaters? We get a show of hands.
One, three.
There's your reason. The PR coordinator and guest book of Ratchet Industries. Round of applause for Liam, guys. Nice shout out.
Always looking fly, by the way.
That's good. That's
one thing to add. It came out around the time of Iron Man 2, which is like pre Marvel when it was just taking off, like May of 2010. So that probably didn't help its track record of audience scores. I mean, I'm a big fan of Popstar, which is another SNL.
Huge favorite.
Not really an SNL comedy, but based off the Lonely Island, I guess. And that didn't track well at all either. It's because they come out at these not great times, and I feel like it's better fitted in like January or October, when it'll fly more under the radar and it won't have as much competition.
It's really interesting about when you release a movie, right? When you're going up against. Because I'm so happy that you said that. I've got the five movies that beat it out in week one, because it was number six at $4 million. Shrek Forever After, like its 30th weekend, was number one. Iron Man 2, Robin Hood, with our friend,
Fat Sweaty Crow,
before he was Fat Sweaty Crow.
He was fearing.
Just watch yourself.
The old thing's jerking.
Can't say that in public anymore, Billy. Letters to Juliet and Just Right, which I don't even know what Just Right is. I did see a hand up here in the crowd, though.
Okay.
I was just joking. He upset the crowd.
Fight.
He's a chill.
So two movies were doing really good when I was young.
Yep.
And then we had like the Not Another Teen whole thing. Ruined spoofs.
Chris Evans.
Right?
Yeah. Who we never know would be anything with the Fantastic Four, right?
Yeah.
So I'm saying this, the Not the Another Teen movies ruined MacGruber. Like, all of those not movies.
Like dumb spoofs that people thought were as good as MacGruber, but didn't realize.
Yeah, like disaster movie and superhero movie and like all that trash that was coming out. They just were pumping it out one after the other. Was that?
Scary movie.
Well, see, but Scary Movie, the first one and the second one, I think, like started something. Maybe that what they started was something horrible. However, the first Scary Movie, I think, is one of the greatest comedies ever. It's so good. Anna Faris is just like, she is so good. So guys, we have a handful of bits left to do here in the show. We're gonna get to a few segments you guys like, you know, Cage versus Cruz, a few other things, but I was excited to go do karaoke after this. I didn't hear as much. People that just walked in on the show are like, what the hell is going on? Is it common? What are these jackasses doing? We're gonna go sing karaoke after this. I'm gonna have to drink a lot more before I get to this. Speaking of which, do we ever get to order a drink while we're up here? Does that happen? Can we do that? I'd like to super jam myself a drink.
Check
my QMC for baby money during this stream.
What do you guys want?
I want a Jameson neat. That works for you.
It's like a tequila.
Tequila soda. Party foul. Trying to deliver drinks on stage.
Yeah. We don't have problems with both.
We don't have a problem. We don't have a problem.
Still working, exactly.
All right, so I think we're going to go to the next part of the show here, guys. This is our favorite line, and this is probably the toughest one in the movie because there's just so many good lines.
Every line is a classic line. And I actually think instead of us starting off, I want you guys to start it off so we don't steal yours. There's so many good ones. What do you guys have? What are some favorite lines? I'll hear from someone new, but I'll hear from the same people, honestly. I'm not that picky.
Right here. Oh, we
got Ash. Ashley. That is one of my most like favorite subtle moments in the movie. He's like, here, you can find me. And it's just, how does he spell it? P-E-N-T-A-O-G-O-N. Thank you, God. So good. MacGruber is illiterate. What else we got?
Similar ourselves. Anything else? Paul, Denuzio.
You owe me a plow pump!
You owe me a plow pump! That's so funny. So I was actually, one of my trivia questions to start off, I was going to ask, what is the brand of stereo? And I didn't think anyone was going to know it, because that's so ridiculously niche and deep. I had to turn on the subtitles when I was in college and rewatch that scene to figure out what it was.
Denuzio, I give you some of the free swags if you have all of them. It's Paul Denuzio. He runs the Patreon. He's a legendary.
What else we got, guys? Got any other favorite lines out there? Oh, Jacob Patrick.
Let's go with, I bet you wish your nose was a dick so you can use
God
it to
damn
fuck
it.
Butt.
That's a true story. So true to I.
Never has one man said that or even another guy been like, God damn it!
So Drew and I were watching this on the stream the other night, and it was a watch along, and we had to stop about 25 minutes in because so many of our favorite lines were in the movie. We didn't really understand why, but I guess we had either both only watched the unrated version or the normal Amazon version. That's a lot of the best lines. So we stopped it. We bought the unrated version so we could keep going. And when I talked to Will last night, I was like, dude, so I gotta tell you something. He's like, what is it, man? And I was like, the regular version of this
you
movie.
You gotta stop
calling me. Is a fucking disaster. Will was like, what do you mean? I was like, well, maybe I've only ever watched the unrated. He was like, no. I was like, well, dude, there's lines that aren't in there. I was like, I mean, your nose could fuck butts. And he's like, no way! That's not in there! You need to send me this link right now. I'm actually upset about it. I started listening off the lines. He was very upset. So, you know, it's something we have to
actually, I want to talk about this moment really quickly because it's actually pretty hilarious. About how technically inept Ben and I are. How terrible the whole thing is technology is slogan. It's the absolute best. I love that we decided to do a last minute watch along for like five people that were loyal enough.
Seven.
Thank you, Danny.
It was as many as nine. One.
We've got several fans.
We were there.
Yes, exactly. It was literally these like the four people, five people right here. It's perfect. It was like, so we decided to do it last minute. We've got these loyal people that are staying up with us late at night on like a whatever Sunday night or whatever it was. And then 18 minutes in, we're like, no, this isn't what we wanted. We're gonna stop it and get a different one. And if you want to continue with us, you have to find it on your own. So Janine goes out and buys the unrated copy right in the middle of it.
Yeah.
Once again.
Talking for a solid 3-4 weeks about these pop sockets we ordered. And the cool shirt designs that Jacob Patrick designed. Unbelievable. Great stuff. So the pop sockets, I don't know how, they're in Cincinnati. That's not here. And the pop socket design, the real small one, this is Action Live, that's the one that ended up on the shirts. So we've got.
So we fucked up!
But we have plenty of signed penguins and guy apples for sale.
What the hell is a penguin and a guy apple?
You guys are gonna find out. We're gonna find out. They're gonna be on the merch table at the end of the night.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Merch table. Sweet stuff. Sweet stuff. What other favorite lines you got out there, guys? Right here, Dwayne.
He took mine. So.
You just wanna call him out?
Yeah.
No, second. Now we got nothing else to say.
My second one, well then, if you'll excuse me. It's time to go pound some cunts.
Yeah, look, she's like a broken record with that thing.
I'm gonna go the one that I remember the first time I watched this movie. Oh, the man. Is this your new one?
Yeah. Oh, you want to do that? All right, cheers. Guys,
cheers
to whoever hooked us up.
Tip your
bartenders. You are welcome.
Yeah, tip your bartenders.
First time I ever watched this movie, the scene where Groob's at the post funeral, he's in there talking to Piper, and he has the ladder saying, like, you gotta help me. I'll do it, don't make me let you. I will suck your dick. I will let you fuck me. You fuck by me, you point the room, also fuck you. It's just porn selling, just tell me what you want me to fuck.
Can you tell me what you want me to fuck? Can you read white out, copy Tony?
And then I love when the colonel walks in and he's on the ground with his pants down and he looks at Piper.
He like shamefully pulls up his whitey tighties.
It's probably the moment watching this movie because the first time I ever watched this movie was with Drew and it was in 2000.
Do you remember what else happened then?
11.
Okay.
It's exactly what you think. It was like 2011 or 2012. We were both like, you know, server bartenders at the time, and one room was place. And Drew smokes a lot of weed. Smokes a lot of weed.
I do. Less nowadays, but this was the time when dabbing was starting to get cool, which basically looks like you're smoking crack, but you're actually just smoking weed. So,
please continue. I'm not accustomed, I'm not a pro. So I went over to Drew's, we turned on MacGruber, and he was like, oh, you gotta try this. It's gonna be cool. We were like new buddies, like we didn't know each other very well, and I was like, press Drew, this is pretty cool. So I try this like little tiny amount of this shit, and within 10 minutes, I was like shivering. I was like, I don't know where I am. This is so uncomfortable. Leave me alone.
And I, at the same time, was trying to be cool because I was like, I got a new friend, and he's having a horrible time watching my favorite movie. I was like, no, you're good, man. This is how it's supposed to be. And he's like, are you sure?
The fact that you still laughed during the movie was shocking. I remember a lot, but I remember the dick sucking. Yeah. That's fucking way part of it. What other people laughed you get?
Comments, yeah.
I like when they re-bring it up, like when they talk to the colonel and then he's like, what do you need me to do? I will suck your dick.
Yes.
That is the one, I've said this every single time,
yeah.
The one thing that I would change in all of MacGruber, and it still bothers me to this day.
He goes back,
he goes,
General, I will suck your dick.
And instead of saying, not this time, Mac, he says, sorry, Groobs, or something like that, but he should have said, not this time, as if he'd done it before. It's the only misjoke in the whole movie, and even to this day, it still bothers me. It's the only thing I wish I could change in all 96.
You'll have to tell Forte and see if that goes well.
Actually, let's call him right now. I think I saw one more, Janine.
No, leave it open.
Like balls. Did we even say ours? Oh, you said yours.
Yeah.
My favorite line, almost everything that he says to Piper in the first half of this movie is my favorite line. But I think my actual favorite line is when, I mean, yes, new rookie out 1 year out of the academy thinks his shit don't stink. Well, guess what? Your shit does stink. Say some shit. That is by far and away my favorite line. The headbutt nose break is also one of my favorite lines.
My fucking nose!
We talk about the fucking ghost thing.
Fucking the ghost, back to fucking the ghost.
Yeah,
no problem.
I think it's great when the like groundskeeper's just looking at him. And he doesn't see anything.
I'll admit, the him having sex, period, is still arguably the funniest thing in the whole movie.
The whole time! That's the time!
He's like, I'm gonna fill you up. I'm gonna fill you up. She goes, this shit. I'm gonna fill you up. What? No,
he's
no, shut up. You're talking. It's horrible. Alright, so what's our favorite line?
This is the next part of the show here, guys. This is something we used to do on the show a lot. It's called Cage versus Cruz. So, we used to do this bit where we would ask if the lead character in the film was played by Tom Cruise or Nick Cage, who would have done it better? And we have a few lines here. We might extend this beyond Cage and Cruz. We have a few favorites on the show, you know, Jerry B or Liam Neeson, now Marty Cove,
Jason Statham.
So we'll just do a couple lines in the voice here.
Yeah, I'll hop in for I bet you wish your nose was a dick, so you could use it to fuck butts.
SpongeBob's your fag, I'm Nick Cage.
Let's see here. First of all, it'll never be me. Second,
oh, I'm sorry. I was talking Upper Decker in the master bathroom.
Rest in peace, Albert. I would love to see Albert Finney try to take an Upper Decker. That is something I would never spend money for. Wait, actually, how did Kyle describe an Upper Decker to you?
No, we got to.
She's not even.
Isn't that
when
they poop in the top of the toilet?
Refresh your memory.
What's the toilet and the poop goes in and you're filling your toilet with poop? It's
brand new video.
You got another one?
Well, Steven, they were fucking great guys and it's a fucking asshole of a day. You walk around on your shit don't stink. Well, I've got news for you. Your shit does stink. It stinks like shit.
Steven, solid Steven.
Let's do some improvisation. Problem is, whenever we do Liam Neeson, it just ends up turning into Jared Butler after 10 seconds.
Really not that great, Adam.
Let's see. First of all, you're never me. And second of all, I forget the question. It was just my other favorite line in the whole movie.
Favorite line in the movie, yeah. I think we're nearing we're running out of some time, so I think we'll move on. Cage versus Cruz.
Oh, yeah, we are. Okay, guys, here are three action movie categories. Totally legitimate. Those are movies like Deepwater Horizon, Gladiator. Not Point Break. There's ridiculously legitimate, which are movies like Point Break, The Rock. Movies that are some of our absolute favorites. And then you've got totally ridiculous. Movies that are just completely off the deep end. They're really hard to hang on to, like Demolition Man. Honestly, Speed is falling into totally ridiculous, even though I love it. What do you guys think? Let's get a show of hands here for people that think that this movie is totally legit.
That's why we're the host and you're over
the
floor.
Yes, yes. What about the middle category? Ridiculously legitimate.
Still two people?
Alright.
Yeah,
three?
Like,
okay.
I know it's coming here.
Rachel, why? Why is it ridiculously legitimate?
Because it is way too much fun. And it's just, it has the entire setup for everything that you love about an action movie. It hits every note that you want it to hit. And it fills everything you want it to fill.
And Powers Booth is the guy. He's the guy in the movie. He's the Ed Harris of The Rock. He's the Nick Nolte of Angel Has Fallen. Powers Booth is the reason why this movie feels even somewhat legitimate. So now I'm gonna say, who thinks it's totally ridiculous?
Yeah.
Well, who didn't raise their goddamn hand?
I'm looking at you.
Democracy.
Ridiculous. Yes, please.
I thought it was
You thought it was totally ridiculous.
In a good way. Like, I love them.
Yeah, I think I think I gotta go totally ridiculous. I mean, I love the movie 100%. It's not legitimate by any means. It's not even ridiculously legitimate, even with Powers Booth in my mind.
No,
I
totally
think it's very close.
Yeah, it's totally ridiculous.
But he has sex with a ghost. It takes an upper deck in the Master Bedroom.
So there's only one last thing left to talk about in the show today, and that's called The Pants! So it's a special one. It's a special one this week, guys. We're actually on Monday. We won't have a show because Drew's not back in New York yet. It's holiday, but the holiday week. A little movie. It's got Powers Booth in it. Maybe you've heard of it. It's called Sunny Day. No, it is going to be moved around on the schedule. I'm going to say that it might be moved around pending scheduling conflicts. In case anyone doesn't know what we're talking about, Matthew Kurtz here has been asking us to cover this movie for 4 years. 210 movies. Yeah, I've done it. There was this period in the 90s where like studios would replace a really good actor with a less good actor and take the same premise. And they did that with Die Hard and Jean-Claude Van Damme, and it's in a hockey rink. And that's the movie. It's literally what it is.
I did not even know that much about it.
Oh, it's just Die Hard in a hockey rink with Jean-Claude instead of Bruce Willis. And Powers Booth is look at how upset he gets instead of Bruce Willis.
You're underselling it now.
Is Powers Booth better than Hans Gruber?
Oh,
don't do it, Kurtz. Do it, Kurtz. You want it covered or not?
This movie's would do it.
The movie is incredible. And I will say, to me, Powers Booth is better than Alan Rickman.
Wow!
Yes.
Good!
I love it. So I think we only have the last few things to do here on the show. That will wrap the action movie anatomy portion of the show. But we did promise a few things. Live music, like you promised live music. I already sang my Biggie St. Elmo part. He promised to dance, so I'm alive. A little while back, I moved to LA 10 years ago. I wanted to be a musician back then. That was what I came out here to do. That I had like an album out, and I toured around a little bit. And about 6-8 weeks ago, I picked my guitar back up, and I've been playing a little bit on our live streams on Action. And I've been doing some of this project work, where I'm gonna kind of, I don't know, like, well, I'll be playing songs from movies basically on the YouTube channel. So that's the thing I'll be working on. But tonight, I'll just be playing a couple. You know, kind of covers things that
you use for your guitar.
Oh yeah, you want to lower that down here? Don't talk to me like that. Yes, I want. Is this low enough for you, sir? It is MacGruber, so. My sister, my brother are here in the audience. Where are they? Can't see them. So right there! They're right there! They live here. And, you know, when I was growing up, my older brother was not here. He was really into hair metal. He's super into butt rock. Like, just like, loved it the most. And, he kind of, as a joke, would tell me about, like, Def Leppard and Poison. But I was 9 years younger, so I thought he was serious. And I was like, this is the coolest thing I've ever seen. I need to be Bon Jovi. And so I like learned to sing all that shit. And so I'm gonna do a couple songs here. That's right. It's a song by Def Leppard.
Now 3, 2, 1, go! I'm in love. I'm in love.
Journey! You guys are the reason why we do what we do. We love you so much. Thank you so much for being here.